new. You don't know what in the world that is. That's from Gulu, Africa, when I was out there preaching, and they screamed it and hollered it and ran over the stadium all, and it was so fun, so exciting that I brought it back to America. It's in 44 states, three different countries, and come to find out, it means I have victory over my enemy. And if you know anything about me, you know I love energy. I love it when you're loud out there. This is not me just doing a monologue instead. It's a conversation. And so on three, be loud about it. If you got victory over the enemy, one, two, three. That's the 11 o'clock service. Amen. We want to welcome those that are watching us on podcast and vidcast for welcoming us into your home or car or wherever you might be. Give them a big hand clap for welcoming us. We love that you allowed us to speak into your lives all over the world. So Mildred was a real gossip of the church in the small town. She was just in everybody's business and loved to share all the newest goodies that happened to be happening in the town. And she enters into the diner one morning, and there was Jack sitting over at the counter there, and she made her way over there kind of a little loud. And then she kind of, as she talked, she announced it in such a way that she knew that the whole diner could hear. And she said, "Jack, I saw your red truck parked out in front of the bar all last night." And as Jack, you know, he went, "Well," and he was going to explain, "Hey, I had some buddies pick me up." And as he started explaining, she's like, no, none of your explanations. We all know, no matter what you say, we know what you were doing all last night with your truck, all parked out in front of the bar all night long." And at that, Jack just kind of got up and kind of pushed his stuff aside and quietly just kind of walked out of the diner. And that night, he took his old red truck and he parked it right in front of Mildred's house and left it there all night long. Come on, somebody out there. Open up your Bibles to our staple scripture for this series, John 16:33, and then we'll go right into Psalm 16:11. We're in a series called Up. We live in a world that wants to keep you down, wants to kick you when you're down, take you down, shove you down, hold you down, everything that the world has to offer. You watch the news and you open up the New York Times, everything was about pulling you down. Why is that? Because the devil knows if he can hold you down, you're never able to lift anybody up that's in your world. And so God's word, everything that I find throughout the scripture, throughout the Bible, is all about up. He wants to build you up and take you up and lift you up, right? Charge you up, dress you up, right? Everything that he talks about is all about up. Because if we're up, then it's easy for us to go out into our world, into our day, into our jobs, into our businesses, and begin to lift those that God has entrusted us up. When somebody is down, we can constantly be giving them a hand up and helping them up and lift them and encourage them up. This is what we were called to do, is to be up. And come to find out, we can be happy all the time. No matter what the world has told you, no matter what you hear out there, no matter what the Zoloft commercials tried to express to you, that we have the ability, come on somebody out there, to be up, to be happy, to have joy, to have peace. We have the ability, and I'm the type of pastor who doesn't just say be happy, but instead I'm giving you the tools in this series called Up, the tools to be happy. Our staple scriptures come out of here, out of John. Throw that up there for me, Betsy, real quickly. "These things I have spoken to you, that in me," somebody say in me. "In me, you may have peace. In the world, you're going to have problems. You're going to have things that don't go your way. You're going to have things throughout your day that doesn't go the way that you want them. But be of good cheer." Tharseo is that word. Tharseo. "But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." Now go to Psalms. "You will show me the path of life. In your presence," once again, "is the fullness of joy." Not some joy, not a little bit of joy, just not a trickle of joy, but it is a fullness of joy. It is a spillover type of joy in our life. "And at your right hands are pleasure forevermore." And you see a theme here that in Christ Jesus, there can be happiness and joy and peace all of the time. This is God's plan. We've been going through the seas of being happy all the time. Number one was your countenance. Your facial expressions. What is your face saying? Because what I do out here has the ability to affect in here. You smile long enough, you start being happy. But what you see for so many Christians, that they're walking around like this, right? They're walking along like this. And I know that I've seen a few of you walking around a little bit like this, right? Yet if we can have the joy of the Lord and we can walk into our day and our life and we can walk around with some happiness and a smile, we begin to change. People begin to mirror what we do. You begin to smile at people. I know there's some people think you're a little creepy, but for the most part, some people smile back. You begin to change your world and your day by smiling. In our parking lot today, I'm driving through and I'm always trying to be smiling. I'm waving like I'm in a parade. And I can't imagine how many people are like, maybe they can't see me over the dash. I don't know. Well, there's a car driving itself. They're like, what's going on with that? But I came today, seriously, literally 15 minutes ago, I'm coming in, and I don't know, maybe I did something wrong. I don't think I did anything wrong, but me and a car came, and we both had to kind of stop, and then one of you, you're here, went like this. You went like that, and then you saw me, and you went. It was the first thing I've ever seen. You know who you are, because I went, like we did the little double hand wave. It was one of my favorite moments of my life. This, come on, you're saved, you're redeemed, you're blessed, you serve a great God. We might as well show that we're happy and we're excited throughout our life. Number two is the law of control is what we talked about, that your happiness is the level in which you feel like you're in control. It's your illusion, whether you're in control or not, that's up to you. Because I know that we feel like we have to do a lot of stuff, but it's not have to do's, it's get to do. And if you change on the inside, you're still controlling your life from the inside out by controlling what you have the power to control, controlling that I'm smiling, controlling the thoughts that I have. You have the ability to control your thoughts. Come on, somebody out there. And the more I feel like I'm in control, the happier I am. A few years back, we moved down to Gilbert for a couple years, and we wanted to make sure that the kids, because growing up, I changed schools so many times, my Lord, I hated it, and so I wanted to make sure that my kids stayed in the same school, so we kept them in the Mesa school system up where they had started out. And so because I worked up here at the church, I was the one, for the most part, not all the time, but Monday through Thursday at least, I'm driving to work anyway, might as well take the kids to school. And so the very first day, I drive out of our little gated area, and right in front of you when you exit the gate where we were at is an elementary school. And at that moment in time, every day is the moment where 1.3 million parents are dropping their kids off for school, if you know what I mean. And for the love of all that's good and precious and holy, I literally have a block and a half to go to get to the main little road over here. But I have, literally, it's a two-lane little road, but there's four lanes of traffic that are going by. And everybody is trying to pull into the school, and these people are trying to pull in the school. And these people won't let these people in, and they won't let these people die. It's a whole bunch of people acting unchristlike all over the place. It's just a whole mess of everything going on, right? And so I get up there, and the first person doesn't let me in. I'm already a little annoyed. The second person doesn't let me in, and so I let the kids. And I said, Daddy may be going to jail today, but I'm going in on the next one. I guarantee you that much. I'm getting in on the next one. We may crash the car. I don't know what's going to happen, but I'm going. And so I wedged myself inside of the, you know, somebody else is like, right? And so I wedged my little stuff in there. Now I'm mad and upset at all the little, right? Everybody's, they're dropping their kids off and they're stupid, annoying kids. I'm sorry. Their kids are across the tree and everybody's all up in the business everywhere else. And finally we pass the school. It's been almost 15 minutes to go a half a block. I'm so annoyed. And I'm like, well, at least we're past the school now. Traffic's going to start going. Nope. Because I can see down ahead. I'm trying to figure out why it's not moving because we have a traffic, the little crossing walk guard, right? She's in her mid-hundreds, like she's like, right, and she's got the biggest smile I've ever seen on anyone's face. She's just smiling, and she's doing a little parade wave at every little car and every little person, and then I notice she'll walk up to every car, and she'll knock on the window, and they'll roll down the window, and she's like talking to kids with her head, and I'm like, for the love, we're not trying to make a relationship, we're trying to get somewhere. What are you doing, right? And so she's just all super happy and annoying, and it's really bugging me at this moment, right? And once in a while, you would hear, it was never me, I'm be honest with you, I wanted to, but I'm Pastor Scotty, and once in a while, somebody would get annoyed, and they would honk, and you would think she would take, like, but instead, I think she thought they were just saying hello, and she'd go, hey, no, we're not honking because we love you, we're honking to keep ourselves from running you over, that's the only reason we're honking. And person by person by person, exhausting, right? And then she got, like, kids across the street, and finally, I get up to her, and here she comes over my window, and I'm like, there is no way in all that's good and holy that I'm going to talk to you because I may strangle you, and I don't think that's good for anyone. And so I just darted right out in traffic. I didn't care. Take me to heaven, Jesus. I'm not going to talk to her whatsoever, right? Off I darted in traffic. This goes on for 2 weeks, every day getting more frustrated and more annoying week after week for 2 weeks. And then I'm doing a teaching on doing your best and being the best that you can. And so I'm like, God, give me some examples, as I love to teach with examples. And I hear God go, crosswalk lady. I said, why would I talk about the annoying lady? That doesn't even make sense. Why would I talk? I'm not doing a series on don't be annoying. I'm doing a series on being great. He says, well, she is great. I said, and I began to think about it. She might be. God said, she's the greatest crosswalk lady ever probably been put on this earth. She's a volunteer who is happier than anyone I've ever seen. No matter what anyone does, no matter what's going on, she's got the biggest smile. She waves. She walks up to cars, even people like you. She walks up to the car every day, and you drive off and annoy them, and you're annoyed at her because she does what you teach. I'm like, well, you're right. Yeah. I'm like, wow, yeah. So I purposed on that Monday that I was going to do a difference. I put a smile on my face, and I decided that I was just going to enjoy this time. And so me and the kids had a little extra time to talk and listen to the radio, and we pulled in, and it seemed like, man, this is fun. I'm not having a bad time. I mean, it's not the greatest time, but I'm having. And we pull in, we're talking, right? Not all the same circumstances and problems, and we get all the way down to the end, and here she comes with a big smile, and I roll that window all the way down, and she puts her head in. She's like, I've been trying to say hello to you for a long time. I didn't want to say I've been ignoring you, but. And so I just smiled. I said, man, you are so incredible. I said, you are just such a testimony of just excellence, and you're always happy, and you're spreading so much cheer. And she's like, yeah, here's a sticker for everyone. And she's giving the kids. She gives me a sticker. We all got little stickers with little smiley faces on it. I'm like, you have a great day. She's like, you have a great day. And we pulled out, and I can tell you that I drove to work happier than I had been in the last 2 weeks. Though I had the exact same circumstances in my life. Now watch this, though. So I get to work, and I'm telling the staff kind of what would happen. And Dan Ballinger, one of our worship leaders, he says, now you know what's going to happen this Sunday. She's going to get up in front of her church, and she's going to give a testimony how every day there was this angry little man. He used to drive all angry, and you know what? I prayed for him, and I loved him every day, and love never fails, and I believe he got saved. I think he got Jesus Christ this week. I got saved. I controlled what I had the power to control, and it brought me peace and joy. Same circumstance. You got the same circumstance. You got to do it anyway. You might as well be happy doing it. That's what I tell my kids. When you got to do your chores, you got to do them anyway. You might as well do them with some joy and some peace. Number three was confidence. That when I'm confident in God's word, it brings security and lets me get rid of the stress and makes me happy. That's what it does. If I believe what CNN says, my God, the world's going to end anytime now. But if I believe God's word, I know that he goes before me and makes a way, that he blesses my hands, that he provides for me. I know what his word says. And if I believe in what my daddy says, it's so much easier for me to be happy. Come on, somebody. You can get loud today. Give the Lord a hand clap. We like that. Number four, we'll spend our time today here. Go with me to Proverbs. Go with me to Proverbs 15:13, and then just to give you a heads up, we're going to go to Galatians 6:7, which will be our staple scripture. Number four is circulation. Circulation. What I circulate. See, everything in creation is about circulation. For the most part, when you think about it. Just in my own body, the blood will leave the heart, and within a minute, it'll come back. And what I've eaten, what I've taken in, all these things, it circulates. What I put into my body seems to circulate. You go out into the world, and the sun beats down, and the water evaporates, and then it becomes cloud, and then it goes up, and then it goes down, and it rains, and then the creeks and the rivers and the lakes get filled, and the oceans and everything, and it just continues to circulate. You plant a seed, and the seed grows up, and then the seed drops other seeds, and then it produces. And everything seems to circulate in this life. Here's the problem, though. When you cut off circulation, then things begin to be numb in life. See, in my body, if I cut off the circulation to a part of my body, that part begins to get annoyed. It begins to, doesn't feel right. It feels kind of funny. And what I want you to see today, that when we don't circulate the right stuff into our life, it makes us feel numb. It makes us feel funny. It makes us feel annoyed and agitated in a sense because we have cut off the circulation in life. Throw up, before you throw up the scripture for me, throw up the definition of joy that we get out of the dictionary. This is the world's definition of joy. The world's definition of joy is an emotion of great delight or happiness caused by something good. So the world says that my happiness is contingent on something good happening. So if everything out there isn't right, then guess what? I don't get to be happy. Everything in life, if it's something's out of whack, I'm not going to. So my happiness becomes contingent on things that I cannot control. And this is why so many people live in a life where they're just quickly happy and then everything really stinks in life. And they're quickly happy and then everything. They live in a roller coaster of life because they've been taught, we've been trained. Everything that we hear through the media is the outside is what affects the inside. But this is not God's plan. Because if that was the way, I have happy, amazing days. How many people know I had a lot of things already today go wrong, and I'm still having a great day? And if my joy was contingent on people in the parking lot not doing this to me, right, and things in the new campus that we're doing and everything running flawless, I would live a very stressful life. But I'm not stressed because I'm not limited by the outside. I do things God's way, which is about what's in me flows out of me into my life. Now watch this here in Proverbs. Proverbs 15:13 says, a merry heart, so what's in me, makes a cheerful countenance, makes a cheerful mind, but a sorrow of the heart and the spirit or life is broken. So the world says that happiness is about what flows to me, but God's word says that happiness is about what flows from me. Yeah, come on, somebody. Now, I'm going to say it one more time. Everything that you hear, everything that oftentimes we've been taught, everything you see on television is happiness is about getting to me. It's about what I take. It's about what I get. It's what about what I can get my hands on. Everything is about getting for me. But the Bible says it's not about flowing to you, but instead the Bible says that it's about what flows out of me. What I put into circulation is going to boomerang in effect back to me. Watch this in Galatians. Throw that up for me. Galatians says this, 6:7. Do not be deceived. God said, don't be ignorant. Come on, get this thing. Everything that you see in my world shows you this principle. Whatever a man, God says, I'm not even going to be mocked for this, for whatever a man sows, that he also will reap. Whatever I put forth into my world is going to dictate what I get or receive back into my life. It's not about whatever I take from the world. It's about what I put into the world that's going to dictate my future. Come on, somebody out there. You're already ahead of me on this right here. It's a boomerang. Now, the world will call it karma. Whatever you want to call it, it doesn't matter to me. God says, I'm not going to be mocked. I'm not deceived. Whatever, it's a boomerang. What I throw out with the boomerang is what one way or another is going to end up coming back to me. It's going to be what I experience in my life, which tells you that I have the power to control what I experience in my future. What I decide to plant today dictates what my farm will produce in my life tomorrow. Life is a farm out there. What I choose to plant. I got a bunch of different little seeds. They got little acorns up here. They got a little peach seed. So if I plant 10 of these peach seeds, what am I going to get in the future? Anybody? I'm not going to get apples? Will I get turnips? No, if I plant, now it's so simple, right? If I plant a peach, I'm going to get a peach. So what I'm saying is that in a way, as a farmer of life, I have the ability to plant what I want to have in my future, which goes with what I said about control. Your happiness is in relationship to how much control you feel like you have. And so now I have ultimate control because I have the ability to change my future. If I don't like what I got, I just got to change what I'm planting. But here is what many Christians do that I see them doing. They whine and complain because, well, everything is a turnip. I got turnips in my marriage. I got turnips with my kids. I got turnips in my job. Everything is turnips. Turnip, turnip, turnip. I'm sick and tired of turnips. I hate turnips. What did you plant this week? Turnips. What are you going to get in your future? Well, I want apples. But you can't get apples until you start planting apples. Well, I don't want to plant apples. I want apples. I want to take apples. It doesn't matter how much you want to take apples. Until you begin to plant apples, you won't begin to experience apples in your life. As long as you plant turnips, You're going to get turnips. And the only way you can change your future is to change what you plant. See, if I'm not happy with what I got, it's very simple. Don't plant what you got. Plant what you want. Don't plant what you want. Well, all I got is discouragement, and I got unhappiness, and I got stress, and I got worry, I got anxiety. Okay, that's what you got. I get that. That's what your farm has. But what's exciting about you today is stop planting those things. Now begin to plant some peace, some joy, some happiness. Begin to plant some love. Begin to plant something different in your life. It's not about taking. It is about what you give into life. We got some of these little seeds here. So, you know, you get the person who just everything, just they're on edge and are angry and frustrated. And the person at Starbucks messed up and they go off. And so these are the seeds that they go in with their home and their family and their girlfriend or boyfriend, their marriage, whatever it might be. And they continue to throw out anger and they continue to do this. And I want happiness. How come I'm not getting happiness? Well, you can't. Plant, God will not be mocked. Whatever you plant into your relationship is what you're going to receive, right? You can't plant turnips and expect to get watermelons. You can't plant turnips and expect to get apples and oranges. You can't. Whatever you put in is what you're going to get out. And so you got stress and anxiety and worry, and everywhere you go, you just bring it with you, and you plant this into any relationship, any person, wherever you go, and you're putting stress out there, and you're wondering, when in the world is my life going to stop being so full of stress? And you go through the house, and you're gloomy, and you're down wherever you go, and everything is just, oh, poor me. And this is what you plant. But then it seems like every circumstance I have is depressing. Well, if that's what your farm looks like, then all you need to do is begin to change what you plant. And as I begin to plant some love into I plant some love into my marriage. Some love and acceptance. Yeah, that person down the Starbucks, they messed up your drink, but you've messed up plenty of times, and what you needed at that time was somebody to love you in that moment just the way that you are and say, it's okay, I too have messed up, and I'm going to plant not what I got, but I'm going to plant what I like, what I want in my future, and I'm going to plant it into my marriage, and I'm going to plant it into my relationship. I'm going to plant not what I have. Because, Pastor, I ain't feeling no love. Okay. Then begin to plant it. And as I begin to plant it and give it, I begin to receive it in my own life. Plant what you want. Come on, somebody. You begin to plant some peace. Begin to plant that in your workplace. Whatever I plant, I begin to experience in my life. I just need to be encouraged, Pastor. I just want to be built up. I want somebody just to recognize all the things I do. Welcome to the club. Everybody wants to be encouraged. Everybody, this is a very low commodity in the world today, is encouragement. And if you continue to go through life trying to take encouragement, trying to get encouragement, it ain't never going to happen because everybody else wants it also. But what if you started off tomorrow by being the encourager? And you went to work and you begin to encourage people and lift them up, and you're awesome and you're amazing. And the Starbucks worker that can't seem to get one order right in the last 3 years, that's all right. You're amazing. God loves you. You're encouraged. And you begin to dish out encouragement to your kids and to your spouse and to your world. And everywhere you go, you encourage. And it will not be long before people begin to encourage you and build you up, because the world is a mirror. Whatever I give, God will not be mocked. I will receive. Man, I'm not feeling any love. Begin to love. I feel no peace. Begin to give some peace. I got no joy. What if you gave a whole day of joy? Everywhere you went, you just joyed everybody up. You just made people happy. Now, I'm not saying that every seed, because if I planted, 10 orange trees, one of them may not come back. Or maybe I won't even know what happened. And maybe a seed flew and went somewhere else. Oftentimes, I know, because people go, well, I love my wife. Well, how long? Yesterday. Well, you may want to plant a little bit more. I do that marriage counseling. We do 15 years of bad, treat our wives like garbage, and then I meet with them, and the next week they're like, well, I did a whole week. Well, you planted 15 years of weeds. It might take a little more than a week. Right? If you were a farmer and you came to me and said, hey, last week I planted a bunch of peaches, and there ain't garbage going on out there. There ain't nothing growing up. It's going to take a little bit of time. But if you'll continue to sow it, God says I won't be mocked. It may take a little time. I may have to water. I may have to put a little manure on it. Put a whole bunch of manure on that. I may have to do some stuff in that. But in time, whatever I plant, whatever I sow, is going to come back to me. Whatever you want in life, put it into it. You want some joy? You want some love? You want some, what do you need in life? Go with me to Luke 6:38.
Luke 6:38. Give, and it'll be given to you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, and it'll be put into your bosom. I know we use that scripture oftentimes with finances, but literally if you read before that, Jesus wasn't talking about finances. He was talking about forgiveness. He was talking about love. For with the same measure that you use, it'll be measured back to you. Which means the more love, if my measuring cup is a teaspoon, and that's what I give with, then I'm going to get a teaspoon back. Whatever measure I use is going to determine. And so if I begin to pour out love with a 5-gallon bucket and a wheelbarrow into my marriage, then the measure that I use is what's going to be used or given back to me. You choose a little bit of love here and there, and okay, I did my little job. Or do you pour out love, whatever measure? God says, come on, whatever you give is going to be given back to you. Pour it out. Pour out something big in this house. Amen. This is, and I've never shared this story before because, and it's one of my favorite stories. It brings me joy. I'm not going to lie to you. So me and Holly, over 23 years, been together for 25 years. It's just incredible. We're very different people. And that's what happens. You get a couple people together, and we've learned that things that annoy each other, we learn to just smile and laugh and enjoy the annoying parts of life for the most part, right? One of the things about me that you have to understand, you probably do not know, and I believe it comes from my childhood. You know, we grew up so poor, we didn't have food in the house. I can't tell you, like, people are like, my kids are like, we're out of food. I'm like, no, I would open the refrigerator and there'd be like a Taco Bell sauce pack, and that was what's in the refrigerator, and some old cheese. That was, now you're out of food. You're not out of food. I was out of food. And so Jason and I grew up with not a whole lot of food, you know, green moldy cheese, and you had to dig down there to find that treasure cheese. Come on, anybody ever had to do that? Right? Yeah, you're like, no, there's good cheese in there. I know. I just got to dig a little further. And so out of this, you know, now that I have a little bit of money and stuff, I love to grocery shop because I love to eat, right? But I hate to run out of stuff. And so, and I don't know what the psychology condition is or what it's called. My wife calls it annoying. I don't know if that's a medical term. That's what we call it. But if we run out of something, my compulsion kicks in. And I don't know why, but I say, we're never going to run out of that. That's what I do. I get to the store. We run out of ketchup. I go, I'll never run out of it because you should never run out of ketchup. Ketchup doesn't go bad. I'm going to buy 5 gallons of ketchup. There we go, honey. But then her personality, she hates Costco size anything. She buys a little, right, a little. There you go, ketchup all gone. Like, she likes to buy the littler stuff just for putting it away in the fridge, and this is what she likes. And so this offsets each other when I come home. So if she finds out I'm shopping, she's like, ah, just come home, let me shop. But I love to shop. She's like, please don't buy anything stupid. That's exactly what she says. But it's in me. And so, like, and she didn't know this till today. This is a true story, that we ran out of cereal. You should, I already know what I'm going to eat the entire week. I already knew for breakfast which cereal I was going to have. I get up and there's no cereal, and I'm so annoyed. So I simply do what's inside of me. I go down to the store, and I bought 19 boxes of cereal. That's a true story. She didn't know because I hid them in the garage, and every time we ran out, I just went out in the garage. I'm not going to run out of cereal. I'm a problem solver. But over the years, I like to, like, if she sends me to the store for something, I love to tease her. It's so fun to come home, and she's like, what in the world is this? I'm like, 5 pounds of paprika. It was on sale. Why wouldn't you buy that? It's like the best $15 I ever spent. She sent me for the pudding. She needed, like, the little puddings for the things. And when I was looking for the puddings, I'm not lying to you, I've never seen anything like it. I believe that the angels put this for me. They had a pudding the size of a television, right? It was like this big. It was like $12. Done, sold. I took that home, hid the other pudding in the car, and I came out. I'm like, here you go, baby. And I kind of walked away. She's like, you got to be kidding me. Well, we had, I was cooking roast. I love a good roast in the crock pot. And what goes with a roast is potatoes. Roast has to have, it's like Sonny and Cher. The two go together. You can't have a, right? You got to have it together, right? And there's no potatoes. And I don't have time to go to the store and get potatoes and cook potatoes. And so I got to eat my stupid roast without potatoes. It gets planted down deep into my heart. And the next time I'm at the store, I'm walking down the produce and I see the big bag of potatoes. I said, we're not running out of potatoes again. And I grabbed 2 huge bags of potatoes. Because you should never run out of potatoes. Potatoes are the one produce that produce themselves. If you leave them long enough, they just grow new potatoes. We should never run out of potatoes. So I bought two big, without thinking about it, as men do, I just bought two big bags of potatoes. And then I got home, and I try to plan getting home when Holly's not there, so I got to load the groceries real fast. And then I'm like, oh my gosh, she's going to be annoyed at the potatoes. So I hid the potatoes in the pantry where I didn't think she would ever see the pantry, you know, the potatoes. Well, I think it was a few days later, me and Jason went to a conference in Seattle. And we're pulling out of the airport. We just got a rental car, and all of a sudden my phone rings. It says, babe. So I said, hey, babe. And right off the bat, it wasn't, hey, how was your trip? It's like, who bought two big bags of potatoes? I'm telling you, I didn't plan this. I never thought of this. This had to be God speaking through me because it just came. It flowed so naturally out of you, right? I just simply said, remember on Friday when I picked up Safi from school? She's like, yeah. I said, the teacher came up to the car and said, hey, we need two big bags of potatoes for a thing that we're doing at school. She's like, really? I'm like, oh my God, I'm glad you called. I almost forgot. It's tomorrow. She needs those two bags of baked potatoes to be brought to the school. And then I said, oh my gosh, I forgot to tell Jason. Kelly also needs to bring two bags because we had our kids in the same classes together. So we hang up the phone, and not 3 minutes later, Kelly calls Jason. And Jason's like, yes, I promise you need two bags of potatoes. And Kelly's digging. And so I hear Jason, and he's a better liar than my guy. He's good at this. He goes, no, honey. Right off the cuff, he's like, no, they're doing a science project. And you know the one where they're able to get electricity out of the potatoes? He said, everybody else is bringing wires and stuff, and they want the Andersons to bring all the potatoes. And so we're bringing two and two. And what makes me laugh is at least I got Holly's potatoes. Kelly, while she's watching all four kids by herself, has to run to the store, buy two bags of potatoes that night in the stress of everything else. But this is what, and when I get to heaven, this is one of my number one things that I want to watch because I wasn't there. It's just what I got to hear happen. It's what I picture in my head. I picture them pulling up into the busy school and all the kids. And it's hard enough just to drop the kids off, let alone find a parking spot, grab two big bags of potatoes with your small child and walk amongst all of the kids and all the parents, all the cars and all the staff who are looking and going, why do they got two bags of potatoes? Walk all the way through the school, knock on the locked door, have the teacher open up, and this is what I want to see in heaven. See the teacher's face and go, why do you got potatoes? Like, you know, could you imagine the teacher going, what do you got the potatoes? You have potatoes, right? And then to hear in their voice go, hey, where do you want the potatoes? And the teacher goes, what potatoes? And then I can hear the little bit of sarcasm that comes out of, because they're annoyed at having to bring potatoes for a teacher. Go get your own potatoes. Go, you asked for potatoes. And so we brought you potatoes. And then the teacher goes, I never asked for potatoes. And then they have to haul the potatoes back to the car. I put things into circulation that have haunted me over that time a little bit. You got to be careful of what you put in, because you're going to get it back out into your life. Come on, somebody out there. What do you put into your day? What do you put into your life? What do you put out there? You get all, you know, oftentimes people can get blaming people who weren't there for them. You know, my dad took off, my mom took off, my parents weren't there. And so we grow up all upset about how people haven't been there for us. And people can go their whole life that way. But what you could do is you could change that cycle right now, this week, just today, by saying, you know what? I'm going to start being there for other people. I'm going to start sowing what I didn't have. I'm going to begin to give what I never got. And as I begin to be there for other people, all of a sudden my world begins to change because God will not be mocked. Whatever I give is what I'm going to receive. And all of a sudden, people begin to give into my life. And people begin, I have shoulders now I can lean on. It was just giving what I didn't have, but yet giving what I want in life. As I said earlier, what happens when a part of your body gets numb? It's not getting circulation. It stops circulating. See, and what I believe that in our lives, God is pouring out so many good things into our lives. He does for me all throughout the day, right down to the person in the parking lot. That was from God. He sets up those funny things and the stories I get. God is pouring out his goodness when I get up in the morning and I take a big breath of fresh air and I look around at the roof over my head and the food that's on my plate and the opportunities that are in front of me and where I live and the church I get to be a part of and each and every one of you. I can't help but say that every moment throughout the day, God is pouring out great things. He's trying to circulate through me. But if I stop the circulation, if I cut off the flow, I begin to feel numb. Even though God's still pouring the same thing out on you, he's still pouring out his same sunshine, his same goodness, his same greatness. He's pouring out. But if you cut off the circulation, you begin to feel numb. You begin to feel agitated. Because the flow was from here down. I can see it within my kids. That if they begin to get unhappy in the home because I ask them to do the dishes or whatever else, it's only because they have forgot about how good they have it. You forgot about it, right? Everything you're enjoying is because of me and your mom. The roof over your head, the air that you breathe, the blood that is coursing through your veins, the floor that you're on, right? Everything around you I have provided, Holly has provided with our time and effort, the clothes that you got on. Man, I am your Alpha. I am your Omega. I am your beginning and your end. I do nothing but pour out great things on you, and you're going to be mad because I asked you to do the dishes? Oh, heck no. You're going to put a smile on your face, and you're going to pour out the same goodness I have poured out onto your life, into your brothers and into your sisters, and as they begin to pour out and begin to circulate that happiness, that circulate that thankfulness, circulate rejoicing and seeing the good things that I do, then they are much happier in the home. But it's when they cut off that circulation that we get upset. Same thing for you. God, if you look for it, oh, you'll see it. He does so many great things right throughout the day for you. He is pouring out so many things, and if you'll just look for it. And I know that oftentimes we can get caught up in our world, and why didn't I get this, and how come I got to do the dishes, and how come I got to do some chores, and how come I do these things? And we get caught up, or we can begin to circulate what we want in our future. We can begin to pour out some love. We can pour out some happiness. We can pour out some joy. You can pour out some peace. Come on, somebody out there. You can pour out whatever you want in life. If you'll live a life this week of giving it and planting it, don't plant what you got. I got nothing but frustration in my marriage. That's just what you've been planting. But what if you just begin to plant kindness? What if you planted just a loving word? Just a nice, gentle hug? What if you just planted what you wanted in your marriage? What if you planted what you wanted in your relationship? What if you begin to plant it in your job? What if you begin to plant it to the people that are around you? This week, I encourage you, make a list. You're in all control. Say, what do I want on my farm? What do I want on my farm? And then list out what you want. And then say, okay, and make yourself a goal. Today, with what measure I give is the measure I'm going to receive. Today, I'm going to plant a whole lot of love. Today, you want some forgiveness in your life? I'm going to plant a whole lot of forgiveness. I'm going to plant a whole lot of acceptance. I'm going to plant a whole lot of love. I'm going to plant a whole lot of being there for people. I'm going to plant a whole lot of encouragement. I'm going to plant this week. And as you plant it, your future begins to change. And before long, you begin to sprout out everything you planted. Bow your heads, close your eyes. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, man, you don't know where you're going to end up when you die one day. This is simple. I know what you may have heard, but usually it's not true. Oftentimes people feel like, well, I have to be good enough to get into heaven. Nobody in this room is ever going to be good enough. That's why Jesus died on the cross. The Bible says he died to redeem you of all of your sins. That's past, present, that's future, because we're all going to mess up in this room. You know, you got junk inside you. We know that. We all got junk. So there's no way that anyone could get into heaven if you have to work your way into heaven. The Bible says no one will work their way into heaven. God won't be mocked. He said no one's going to work because Jesus died on the cross. So the only sin that'll ever keep you out of heaven is not believing in Jesus. That's the only one. And so if you'll believe that he died on the cross and was rose from the dead, you're going to heaven. No matter what you do, you're going to heaven. Then we can start to work on the other junk that's inside so that you can live a better life down here. So we're going to say a prayer. If you say it with me and believe it, your eternity instantly changed. You want to change where you're going to spend eternity? This is the time. This is your moment. Everybody say this prayer out loud so nobody's embarrassed. Dearly Father, I ask you right now, forgive me of all of my sins. I ask you, dear Jesus, come into my life. Be my Lord and my Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Keep it's a little dark. Hey, live a blessed life. Figure out what you want into your future and then begin to plant it. If you don't like what you got, just plant something different. You got turnips? Plant some peaches. We need your help to take this word all over the world. I encourage you to get online right now. Don't ask God how much to give. Just how much. Not if, how much. Because I need your help. We need your help to get this message all over the world. And so every little bit counts, whatever he puts on your heart. Be blessed. I'll see you next time.